Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the morning studies this week. We're continuing our study of judges, putting these judges on a line with particular waymarks being dated as much as possible. But before we begin, can you join me in a word of prayer? Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for your word, the precious words of scripture that are life to us. We just ask, Lord, that as we open your word together, that your words can speak to our hearts, to our minds. You can strengthen us in our character, our thoughts and our feelings can be transformed by the power of your Holy Spirit that inspired the scriptures. Help us to understand the things we read and to reveal your character as it's worked out in our lives through the power of your word. And I pray, Lord, that you can be with this movement for those that are searching and studying for truth. Give us strength to walk in the light that you give us. And we also pray, Lord, that you can help each person as they face the particular difficulties that they have. Be with us now, we pray and ask. In Jesus' name, amen. So we started looking at Jephthah, putting it on a line last Thursday. And the story of Jephthah has, you know, we've gone through it a couple of times. And we understand the story that it applies to our history. And so just to kind of get people's minds back into it. So Jephthah is a Gileadite, right? He's this son of a harlot. And so he's going to, after Gilead's wife, bear him sons. His sons, Gilead's sons, are going to thrust out Jephthah. Now, how did we look at Gilead? This is a person, of course, right? Even though it's, you know, it's from the area of Gilead as well. So what does it represent? Because who's thrusting out whom? Remember, these are messages. Because Gilead is just a rocky region, right? That's what the word means. It's related to other word, Gilad. Anybody remember, how did we understand Gilead as a message? Nobody remembers?
No, I don't. I can't remember.
I'm looking at Genesis 37:25, and it says, they sat down, these are Joseph's brothers, to eat bread, and they lifted up their eyes and looked, and behold, a company of Ishmaelites came from Gilead with their camels bearing spicery, etc. So, could have something to do with the message of Joseph.
Yeah, we have Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. So they're going to be coming from that area that's it's on the east side of the Jordan. It's in the northern part, up north of the Sea of Galilee, or in that area. But as a message, in our lines, the message of Jephthah in the judges line, we've been marking as December 6th. So I'll just show you here. So this is where we mark the message of Jephthah. It's the formalization of the second angel's message. And the second angel's message arrives July 18th, 2020. And then December 6th, 2020 is going to be in this judge's line, this rejection of the message. So if it's Gilead and it's thrusting out Jephthah, we know that this actually occurs earlier, because even though we have this waymark, this whole line of Jephthah encompasses this line, right? It's just that its waymark is here. So we're zooming into this formalization of the second angel's message waymark, and it's going to be illustrated by Jephthah. And since Jephthah is forced out by Gilead, Gilead must refer to a message that is related to a rejection of time. So that's what's been happening all through this history with this message of Jephthah. So the message of Jephthah must relate to time in some way. And the message of Gilead is this rejection of time. That's how we understood it. Okay. Now, so we know that this is going to cover the history prior to this, right? So just because we got Jephthah here at the formalization of the second angel, because we're zooming into that waymark has a history or a line that doesn't just begin there on December 6, 2020. It's not just that waymark, because all of these other waymarks can relate to the message of Jephthah. So when we look at putting something on a line, the first thing, of course, we always want to do is know what is the darkness. And so if we look at this line of Jephthah, and all this stuff is wrong, this 45 years, this is from the previous line. Okay, so Angela says, Collins' enhanced emphasis on time will help bring more attention and acceptance to messages related to chronology, hopefully. Okay. Well, I think there's a problem there. So Collins' emphasis on time, the problem with it is it's predictive. And we know that time isn't predictive. We can measure the time of past events, but we can't predict events. So we can look back at the past and we can anticipate those, the significance of that chronology by what I call watching and waiting, is measuring the time, looking at the structure we already have and anticipating that structure in the future without understanding what those events mean, what those dates mean. So we don't know what events fall there. And I would think it's sort of a two-edged sword. That is, I think with the predictive element of Collins' dates, that it's going to cause many people to fall away. That's part of the problem with the time messages. And that's been true all through the period in which we've had time messages. It's actually been one of the most a divisive elements within the movement, is that we predicted things that have not occurred. And it's been an excuse for those that lack faith to just abandon the message altogether. So
wasn't that designed, though?
Yes, I'm not saying it wasn't designed, but I'm just saying that it's not like I believe that Collins' messages are going to help the message as far as the people are concerned. That is, what we have to be able to do with Collins' understanding of time is correct it within the movement. That is, we need to come to an understanding of what time means, and we haven't. But As far as this chart here, so this we're going to be drawing out Jephthah, and obviously these marks, these periods of time, are not going to be a part of it. Right, so we just have this bare line right now. But we know that Jephthah represents the formalization of the second angel's message on the line of the judges. And that's December 6, 2020. But we know that this then relates to time, and that the Gilead represents those opposed to time. And the message of Jephthah relates to time, and particularly to the elements that we have in understanding time, the symbols, symbolic dates, everything that's rejected in the December 6, 2020 declaration, because that's Jephthah. Now we know in the story of Jephthah, so if we go here, Jephthah is thrust out initially. And that, of course, is part of the history of Jephthah. That is, this message of time was not well accepted within the movement. Not time prediction per se, but just time as a symbol, as a way of analyzing and understanding our lines. We had some of it that would be unrelated to anything that I did. I mean, the 126 years from 1863 to 1989, for instance, is not something that came from me or anything. But so there was elements of time. But as we started to look at the chronology itself, there became an increasing resistance to what I was doing in analyzing chronology. Now, Jeff was accepting it, but it wasn't well accepted within the movement. And I always had a hard time understanding it because it was something that was quite objective. You know, and we can see this with Stephen's charts. I mean, just how these things all fit together. but there was a resistance to it. Now, part of it would be that it's not everybody's cup of tea, so to speak. That is, numbers and dates are not easy for everyone. And it was a little more complicated in that sense. For people to get their minds around it, to see what was happening. Though it wasn't impossible. I mean, people who aren't mathematicians could look at the lines and at least, you know, confirm them and see that it was correct. But there just wasn't a general acceptance of it. So we see that Jephthah is going to be thrust out. And that definitely does happen with this message relating to time. Now he's going to flee from his brethren and live in the land of Tob. In Hebrew, that's Tov, that means goodness or good. And there were gathered vain men to Jephthah and went out with him. Now, of course, this idea of vain, that would be useless, empty, worth, you know, figuratively worthless men. Now, what would that mean as far as the message is concerned? Why does Jephthah have vain men attached to him? Is this a positive or a negative thing?
It seems to be a negative.
Okay. This is a message. Now, and so we could take worthless in the sense of like morally worthless, but it also could just mean men who are not they're because if we're looking at, I mean, it's obviously not men per se. But this message is attached to things that are not powerful or significant. I mean, we could just look at this message as sort of an underground message, right? It's pushed out, it's thrust out, and now it's having to sort of fend for itself, so to speak, with whatever opportunities that present it. Does that make sense? Or am I not clear?
It's reasonable.
Okay. Okay, Ezekiel 34, what does that have to do with this?
It speaks of false shepherds casting out God's sheep and how God is going to restore his sheep. He's going to deal with those false shepherds.
Okay. So yeah, so Jephthah's pushed out, and so I mean, I think the message of Jephthah is the message of chronology. And so that there were gathered vain men to Jephthah. I don't think we're going to look at this as like evil men. They're just common men. They're just not important men. And so that that message of the study of chronology would be connected with just the underground element of that message. And that's what we see, right? So the whole time that, chronology is happening in this movement, there isn't an interest in it. Now, of course, often I attach that to myself, but you could even look back in 2010. So Johannes Kalecki, he's going to put that paper out on the story of Joseph, dealing with the 2520 from the story of Joseph. How you could show the 2520 for Northern Israel without any reference to Leviticus 26, just by using this parallel from Joseph and Christ. And I found, of course, more, I found the connection there in much more detail, but and he had taken these periods. We have the periods of pagan persecution, the 504 years from 34 AD, and the 1260 years, putting them together to be this 7 times 252. Now, what he didn't do is he didn't count back. So he's going to have this as the 2 and the 5, right? It's from the story of Joseph. But he didn't count back. That was Stephen and I in 2016, counting back to 1764 years from 34 AD, coming to when the year in which the 12 sons of Jacob are blessed, the year that Jacob dies, tying those two structures together. So it's not something that he had done, right? So there was, he had given the basic groundwork in the story of Joseph with the prophetic mirrors. But he hadn't, and he had used those as the plenty and the famine with the 2 and the 5 following that. That's going to be part of the famine. But he didn't connect the whole structure in the way that Stephen and I did. So, but all I'm saying is that that message of Johannes Kalecki's, the paper is an amazingly powerful paper. But it's not accepted in the movement. Nobody's talking about it. Right? Chronology is pushed aside. Even so, when I came into the movement in 2010, that's going to be in November of 2010. And Johannes Kalecki had put this paper out in April of 2010, but nobody's talking about it. There's no presentation, there's no discussion. It's just a paper that is ignored. And so now part of the reason, or part of the question, I guess, is what's the reason that chronology is thrust out according to this story?
It's not from the lawful wife's.
Okay, it's not from the lawful wife, and the lawful wife is the Seventh-day Adventist Church, right?
Right.
Okay. And when we look at the church, how does the church react to chronology, especially symbolic use of numbers? What do they consider it to be?
Time setting,
right?
And not just time setting, it is time setting, but it's, which I think is a big part of it. But it's also numerology, right? That
Yeah, I've
is,
heard it called that.
it's the
No,
son, it's the son of an harlot. That is, it's something that the church has never endorsed in any official way. Our scholarship doesn't support it. They would never look at chronology in the way that we do. They wouldn't see any significance in these spans of time or these dates, that we could take the fifth day of the fourth month in Ezekiel chapter one and tie it to the fifth day of the fourth month in 1844, or the first day of the first month even in 457, and the first day of the fifth month in 457, and tie them to the events in Millerite history. They just wouldn't do that. They definitely wouldn't take like a span of days and see that it symbolizes a date. So 54 days symbolizes the fifth day of the fourth month. The church would not do that. And I would say that to a large degree, the problem in the movement with chronology is that it's numerology and it's time setting. So when I started presenting my analysis of chronology, I mean, the first thing that Jeff asked me before he actually made the invitation was, well, are you putting these dates into the future? Are you seeing any pattern for some future date? Just not because he wants that, because he doesn't want that. Right? He likes the chronology because he sees that it fits with our message. But like all of us, we don't want to have dates in the future. And of course, I assured him, we're not, I'm not looking at any future dates. I mean, that wouldn't even cross my mind. So in 2014, I'm not thinking, well, we can look at these dates in the past and this is going to help us make some prediction about dates in the future. Just not going to make that leap. But when you do it, people are going to have that question in their minds. What, why is he doing this? What does it mean? Are you going to now start predicting when Jesus is going to come back? Because every time in Adventism, in my experience, people who do the types of things that I would do, like analyzing the prophetic periods in the past, or looking at the Jubilee or sabbatical cycles, or the chronology of the Bible, for the most part, it's so that we can sort of predict, like people are going to always be doing that. I mean, the most amazing thing too, if you look at the 6,000 years and you look at people who are trying to work out the chronology, the vast majority of them are trying to work out the chronology of the 6,000 years so that they can find out when it ends so they can know when Jesus comes back. I mean, that's going to be the main reason why people have interest in that chronology, to figure out when was creation so that we can know when Christ is going to return. Of course, we don't have 6,000 years from creation to the second coming. We have 6,000 years from the origin of sin to the second coming. And so we don't know when the origin of sin occurred. When sin began, we don't have in the Bible any suggestion of when that was, other than we know that it has to be, less than 100 years, let's say, and probably even less than that, from creation when Adam and Eve sinned. But the Bible doesn't give us any indication, or the spirit of prophecy.
Well, that would it would have to be between Shem, right? When Shem was born and when Adam when Eve was created.
You mean Seth?
Seth, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Seth.
Well, yeah, it'd actually have to be before
Before that, Seth, that
well,
is.
before Cain was born.
Yeah, but we don't know when Cain was born, so that's moot.
Oh, I see what you're saying. But well, it's not completely moot because Cain is at least going to be an adult.
Yeah, but he's not in the chronology.
I know, I understand. But still, Yes, we. But that's what I'm saying. Is that's why I'm saying 100 years or so, because we're assuming that Cain and Abel are grown, right? Because of the work they're doing,
Yes.
so, right? So that's why I'm saying, yeah. So we know it has to be at least, can't be much less or much more than 100 years, and maybe quite a bit less, based upon that chronology. Definitely, it's before Seth is born, but it's before Cain and Abel are born as well that sin occurs. So we don't know. I mean, it could have been 70 years after. We just don't know. So when it comes to, anyway, the point is we have this chronology. The message in this movement connected with chronology is illegitimate. And Gilead would be a message that relates to the lines. So Gilead is going to, because it's going to be the sons of Gilead who are going to thrust out Jephthah. And so Gilead must be some kind of message that relates to prophecy. And his wife, he has a harlot wife, right? She's a harlot who has this son Jephthah, but he has a wife who bears him sons. Doesn't say how many, but when the wife's sons grew up, and they thrust out Jephthah, so though that must be a message that comes from Gilead. So Gilead must be some relationship to Adventism in some way, whether. The prophecies of Adventism, maybe the 2300 days and all these different time prophecies. Right? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it's sensible.
Okay. And Jephthah is going to flee to the land of good. And there were gathered vain men to Jephthah. So I have to say that these vain men, even though they're vain men can refer to evil men. In this context, I don't think so. It's just men who are not valuable in the sense of the world. They're not great men, right? we might say mean men, still old-fashioned word, but men who are not of any value. But so this is an underground studying of chronology and time, which would represent how this is happening in parallel with the movement, but not part of the movement. That is, the movement is not studying these things. It's going to be underground. But it came in process of time that the children of Ammon made war against Israel. So, once again we have Ammon. This is means inbred, he's the son of Lot, right? And they're going to make war against Israel. And it was so that when the children of Ammon made war against Israel, the elders of Gilead went to fetch Jephthah out of the land of Tob. So Jephthah ends up being called to this message, right? It's going to be appealed to, right? We need you. And that does happen, right? When it comes to chronology and time.
Yes.
Okay. And now the thing that's interesting about it too is we know that dealing with Parminder's message and the time setting that he had, that time setting in some ways is also cast out. It would be included in this. Right? Because Parminder first had a message based upon time that was then cast out. But it's now going to be revived. And so one of the reasons that we even get to July 18th and November 9th is that time gets reintroduced into the movement, not particularly time setting yet, But just a deep analysis of the chronology now becomes needful for the movement itself. So this message is called into this, to this back into the movement, so to speak. Now that's going to happen in 2016, and progress over a period of time. That is, in 2016, we know that Thabo, Parminder, and Marco are ordained as elders. There's going to be this. We're going to have Mark Bruce sort of leave the movement in that period of time. But there is the study at the School of the Prophets. So we're addressing these 70 years. So one of the reasons that this ends up becoming an issue has to do with the chronology of the Babylonian captivity. That is, Parminder is making some arguments regarding the 70 years. And in 2016, Michael and I are wrestling with this 70 years. There is a disagreement between Parminder and Mark Bruce that I'm not really aware of. But me, Stephen, and Michael ended up, and Heidi, we went to Alabama. So the people in Alabama were actually followers of Mark Bruce, which we did not know. And the ones that were the leaders in that weren't there, but we presented in Alabama. Michael and myself, Stephen didn't present, but he was there, regarding the periods of 70 years. So at the time, I didn't understand all what was happening behind the scenes and why there was this resistance to this period of 70 years and how this fit in. But this really had to do with Mark Bruce. And because the people who weren't the leaders weren't there when we did these presentations, they were well received, but after we left, there was an undermining of that that was going on. So we didn't know about this. And then, so in 2016, me, Michael, and Stephen are working on this chronology. Mostly it's me and Michael, and me and Stephen. We're not all working together per se. Though Stephen is there when Michael does some of his presentations. Now, what's going to end up happening is in 2016, is of course the study on Ezekiel, where we now pair together Ezekiel, the prophecy of Josiah, and Revelation 9, Josiah Litch's prophecy. These are paired together, and Jeff recognizes this. This is presented on July, it's going to be July 16th. Let me think. July 16th, 2016. Jeff is going to make the DVD of my presentation, and that is going to be shared far and wide everywhere he goes. He's going to be handing out these DVDs because of the importance of it. But it's going to be overshadowed by some of the other studies that come along. And then, of course, the division. Every time light comes to the movement, there ends up being these major divisions and conflicts. And so Mark Bruce is going to leave. He has his spies, the two guys from Alabama who end up at the School of the Prophets. They end up leaving. And that's in 2016 into 2017. So there's going to be all this division that's occurring in 2016 into 2017. Of course, Michael's going to leave. Brittany and then people from the Alabama group. So this is going to happen sort of in stages. It doesn't happen all at once. So the point here is that time, the time element, the chronology starts to become important. In 2017, it's first going to be about the prediction before midnight. And then blessing suggestion of May 2nd as being the symbol of the prediction before midnight. And then that's going to lead to the whole studying of Samuel Snow's letters that in 2017 is going to be presented by me at the School of the Prophets, as well as the symbol of July 18th. So then that's going to pretty much be rejected, though Jeff continues to study it and present Samuel Snow's letters in 2018, because he starts to get it. But along with that, we have all this time setting that then comes back through Parminder and Tess. But it's going to be the prophecy of Ezekiel and Revelation 9 that is going to witness to the date that Tess provides, November 9th, 2019. So you can start to see what ends up happening is that Jephthah is invited back in to the movement, that messages of time and chronology. And then this is going to be a formalization of this message related to time, July 18, right? So even though the line it comes after, it's still going to exist before as a line itself. But so we can see how the July 18th message, which is the arrival of that message related to time, and its formalization is going to be its rejection on December 6, 2020. So then when we look at this story here, it has to do with Jephthah being the head, right? So they want to make him the chief or the captain or whatever the words are. So he wants them to be, what's the word? Captain, right? Head and captain over them. And then he's going to utter these words before the Lord in Mitzpah, right? So we know Mitzpah is going to be the watchtower. And that's going to be Judges 11:11. So that's going to be important here. So Jephthah went with the elders of Israel, Gilead, and made him head and captain over them. And Jephthah uttered all his words before the Lord in Mitzpah. So why is this significant that this is Judges 11:11? How does that help us in placing this on a line? So any thoughts on this so far, what my summary has been about? So here we have the line of Jephthah. We haven't done anything with it yet, other than we know that it's going to be like any other line, and it's going to have a period of darkness, and this is going to relate to chronology, and there's going to be these waymarks. We haven't figured out even when it begins, but we have this 11:11. So what does 11:11 tell us?
November 11th?
Okay. Well, okay, 11:11, Daniel 11:11, the 11 years that Joseph is in Egypt, to the butler and the baker's dream, and the 11 years then again to his dream being fulfilled, right? So the 22 years together, 11:11 is 22, but it's divided in this way, the 11 generations to the flood, the 11 generations from the flood into the going down of into Egypt, right? So we have lots of 11:11. I'm born on the 11th day of the 11th month, according to the biblical calendar in 1963. So that's my birthday is 11:11 if I was a Jew, right? So we have this 11:11 symbol. So where would we put that 11:11 symbol on this line? Okay, so first off, it's a doubling, right?
Yes.
Okay. So can we say it relates to the second angel's message in this line?
What is a doubling? So I'd have to say yes.
Okay. Okay, so we got now we're going to place this. Well, I'm just going to do this. I'm just going to be bold about it. Because this is the message in relation to time. And I'm going to say that this is January 11, 2020, whether this is right or not. But I want you at least to consider this. And then so this is Judges 11:11. Now, why would I put that there?
Well, it brought clarity for chapter 11, or it says, I'm sorry, January 11 brought clarity, or the chapter 11 of Daniel. Brother Daniel's study triggered Jeff to find more light on that subject.
Yeah, and it was actually 11:11 more specifically that he saw, because there was this controversy about Daniel 11:11. That is Daniel 11:11, as the king of the south shall be moved with choler, and shall come forth and fight with him, even with the king of the north, and he shall set forth a great multitude, but the multitude shall be given into his hand. So this is the battle of
Oh, Paniam?
Raphia.
Raphia?
Yeah, Peniam's going to follow.
Right,
That's
I'm sorry.
13, when the king of the north shall return, right? Daniel 11:13. So the king of the south, and when it says that, but the multitude shall be given into his hand, it's kind of obscure sometimes who the personal pronoun is referring to. But when it says he shall set forth a great multitude, that's going to be the king of the north, right? But the multitude shall be given into his hand. The his there is the king of the south's hand, right? So it's not always clear. I know I'm looking at the verse and you're not, but if we look at Daniel 11:11, and we look at just our standard understanding from the Daniel and Revelation and what we understand, how we've looked at this. Also in the, what am I here? Gonna be this verse. There we go. So the kings of the north and the south in conflict, right? So this is going to be the Battle of Raphia. Okay, so that's the issue here. Now, so of course, it's about the Battle of Raphia, but Jeff is addressing here 63 days from November 9th to January 11th, 2020, and then 63 weeks to March 27th, 2021, right? 63 weeks is 441 days. And this is going to be all about the Levitical chiasm. So this is what Jeff comes to understand, is this connection between November 9th that he sees more clearly on January 11th, but it also becomes part of a structure. So now I'm saying that this is the arrival of a second message. Now, somebody might say maybe that's more an empowerment of a message, but I'm just saying that in this message related to time, because we know long before this, we're going to understand Raphia, And maybe I should move this over, but I'm just putting it there for now, just as a thought experiment, because of the doubling of it. Now, when it comes to this period of time, we're going to say that that there's something connected with this history, that this is about time. Now, time comes into this movement or chronology over here. So there's a period of darkness. So what is the darkness then that relates to time in this movement? What is it that this movement is dark about that's going to come and is going to be the first message? Because this wouldn't be November 9th, 1989, or even 1919 or 20.
That would have to be the darkness. It would have to be our lack of understanding of chronology, at least the start of it.
Yeah, okay. So a lack of understanding of chronology. But what aspect of chronology? I mean, because this movement had chronology. We had Dwayne Dewey, who was the chronologist in the movement, right? So he was interested in the chronology. His chronology wasn't correct, though. That is, he had lots of mistakes in his chronology, because his chronology was the chronology of basically of Usher, right? He
Right.
just Usher's chronology. And Usher's chronology had lots of problems with it that Dwayne Dewey was not familiar with, because he just sort of assumed Usher's chronology was the correct chronology. He didn't look at any other information. So Raphia is June 22nd, 217 BC. Could we then highlight a midnight and 622 here, connections with Sunday law? Or what's the SSL? I don't know what SSL is.
Samuel Snow's letters.
Oh, okay. Okay, Samuel Snow's letters. Yeah, I don't really like abbreviations like that, but anyway. Okay, so Samuel Snow's letters and FFA. Okay, so June 22nd. So we know that June 22nd is going to be that date. Now, of course, he's not really aware of Samuel Snow's letter, June 22nd. Right? He's not. He's, when June 22nd, when he starts talking about it, he's not connecting it to Samuel Snow's letters. I can't remember when he first starts talking about that, but it's quite a while before, and then it comes back to him again, because he knew about receiving the 165,000 on June 22nd, 2011, and then again June 22nd, 2014 is going to be the first camp meeting in Arkansas. Once he's moved there. There was the Ozone Arkansas camp meetings, but those were earlier. So they have this first camp meeting after they have had the School of the Prophets, though they don't have it at the School of the Prophets. They have it at Lambert Church, because there isn't room there yet. But they have the School of the Prophets. He has the students there, Michael, Tyler, and Brittany. So that's going to be in 2014. That's going to be June 22nd. That's going to be, I believe, the camp meeting where Noel is going to put together that the midnight cry occurred on August 15th, 1844. That is going to be the first day of the fifth month. So, and then we're going to have established the first day of the first month is April 19th. So that's going to be in 2014. So that would be related to time. So One of the things we can say is that when we're going to deal with this time, I think it's going to have to address the symbolic use of dates. So, I mean, we could start that way back in 2013, maybe, because we're going to look at the first day of the first month. But it's going to arrive somewhere in that history. Somewhere, I mean, I'm saying you could put it all the way back to Johannes Kalecki, 2010. But it's not being accepted in the movement, right?
Yeah, I thought it was starting to be more accepted later down past 2012, I thought.
But even, yeah, because even in 2012, we could say that with the rejection of Parminder's time setting, that it still isn't accepted yet. Even though we have dates and stuff and we start seeing some things, there comes a point in which the movement starts to become comfortable with common. And I think that's going to have to relate to what is done with the first day of the first month. So I don't know what date we could mark the first day of the first month as being this significant, this event when time is accepted. But I think it would have to be in 2014. And that, of course, agrees with the understanding that I had regarding time that then is presented in Arkansas in 2014. So whether you wanted to take June 22nd as the arrival of this message, you know, that's a possibility. 2014 is when I've always marked time coming into the movement. So the darkness relates to time. Now, Judges 11:11. So if I put there, you know, we could just say, you know, this is the empowerment. Right, but we have other events that would be a formalization of this message and an empowerment, as far as I can see. And it's the doubling of Judges 11:11 that I would look at as arrival of a second angel. Now, this, of course, could be moved over. It could be the formalization of the second angel or the empowerment of the second angel, right? Because it's a doubling, it doesn't mean that it necessarily happens when the second angel arrives. But I put it there. So hopefully people are seeing that this all fits, but we just so we're gonna put 2014 here. But that's when I would put this arrival. So before that, we see that the message is what was the word there? Thrust out, right? And Jeff
right.
The words expelled. Right. So they thrust out Jephthah. And so we could see that prior to that, Jephthah's being thrust out. But now in 2014, a message arrives to this movement, and that's going to be the message about the first day of the first month and the first day of the fifth month. Right. So that's going to be Ezra 7:9. Right. That's going to be a message that comes to this movement, that now we have the symbolic use of numbers, of dates, right? Not just of numbers, but dates now can be symbols. And they're going to begin looking at, you know, in the Bible, the first time they see the first day of the fifth month. That's going to be what happens on the first day of the fifth month, first mention. Anybody remember?
That's when Ezra went to Jerusalem.
No, that's not the first mention.
Oh, first day, first month.
The death of Aaron?
Oh, yeah,
Aaron
the first,
died?
Yeah, so the first day of the fifth month, right? Yes, you're going to have the death of Aaron, okay? So we now then are looking at numbers in a symbol or dates in a symbolic fashion, right? We never did that before. Correct? We didn't look at, you know, the first day of the fifth month and try to say, well, this happened before, so this is a symbol. And the reason they do that is because we have a connection in 457 BC to events in 1844. And that's going to be 2014. And this definitely relates to how we look at time and chronology now. So until 2014, we don't have that. Even in my study of chronology prior to that, I did not have that. Right? 2014, we start to understand this. And so I start to apply it. But it still takes time to develop. But when we get to January 11th, that symbol there, Jeff is then going to take January 11th and he's going to write the dates September 7th, November 9th, January 11th on the board. This is going to be on March 30th, I believe, that he does this. Right. So Jeff is going to do this March 31st, 2020. Jeff is going to draw those dates on the board. But Odilio sees this and notes that if you take 9-7, 11-9, and 1-11, and you add them up together, what do you get? You get 327, right? Sorry about that blocking the screen. So you're going to get 327. And that's going to be the date, which in the same system would be March 27th. And Jeff had already marked the 63 weeks from January 11th to March 27th, 2021. Right? And then I'm going to notice that if you flip them into European or Canadian or British dates, where you put the day first and then the month, and you add them together, you still are going to find that you're going to get this structure. But the date that you're going to get is the starting date, January 11th. So you're going to get the starting date of that 63 weeks. So Jeff is going to give the end date, but I'm going to give, but doing it this way, you get January 11th itself. So that's going to be, instead of 9-7, you're going to have 7-9 plus 9-11 plus, however, I did it. I think I did it with the, let's see. I'm just showing you here. So let's just do these calculations. Right. So the first one, I'm just going to do it again. 9-7 plus 11-9 plus 1-1-1 equals, oops, did I do wrong? Oh, I did that. Didn't hit the 9 there. So 9-7, September 7th plus November 9th plus one, one, one. Right, so we get 327. And then if I do it the other way around, 7-9 plus 9-11 plus I get this date, which is the 11th day of the first month, January 11th. So notice I write those dates differently there, but we can get rid of the zero. So I get January 11th again. Okay. So I think that's significant. Okay, related to the contempt and the expulsion of Jephthah, Galatians 4:30, that's going to be dealing with Genesis 16 and 21. God still raised up a great nation, although not covenant members as a group. Okay, so this expulsion of Jephthah, this basically thrusting him out, is related to this message. So now we now have, so this message of time. So now we have time invited back in, and it's invited back in 2014, right? Does that make sense to people? And it's because of the symbolic use of dates that we now have not just chronology, but we have an analysis of chronology and of time that definitely relates to July 18th. Now, if we go back to this, before we actually go back to the diagram. So we're trying to match up these events. I mean, we can easily put things on a line, but now we have to look at the symbols. Now, it came in process of time. In Judges 11:4, I just want to look at that again because we probably forgot about that. But here in this expression we have the word yom there, right? It came to pass in process of time is how they translated it, but it's just the word min yom. So min, it just means with or together with. The days. Now in Hebrew, when we look at this verse, it's a little more complicated than that. So you got mimyom, and it was, and what was it here? There's something about this expression. I can't remember what it was. Let me see if I can. No, it's not going to help me. Okay, so in Brown Driver's Briggs, it says, a yom means day, time, year, day as opposed to night, 24-hour period. Days, it could be the lifetime of a person, time, a period, a year, temporal references, today, yesterday, tomorrow. So this word yom is very broad. Okay, so let's put it that way. And can we see that it represents all of these different symbols of time? That is a day, a period. So that is a date, a period of time. So can we see that this would relate to that message of symbolic use of time and dates?
Yes.
Yeah. So, and we're going to have it on this verse 11:4, which is 4:11, which is information. If we go backwards. So there becomes this, in process of time, there's this war or this conflict. So the children of Ammon are having a conflict with the children of Israel. And it's here then that they resort to using Jephthah again. He's been thrust out. They didn't like him. And they went to fetch him from the land of Tov, right? So from good. A region apparently east of the Jordan. We don't know where it is exactly. And so Jephthah now is going to be used to fight against the children of Ammon. So what particularly are the children of Ammon then? Because they're not representing the period of darkness in this case, because we say the period of darkness has to do with this message of time, but they are relations, right? So this is an internal conflict in this movement. Now, why do the elders of Gilead, why does this message that has been connected to the woman, to the wife, which is the church, why is it now seeking Jephthah to fight against Ammon? So what would the message of the children of Ammon be? What is the conflict that's going on here? So where are we going to take, what are we going to take from these verses to mark, because we're saying the arrival of the second angel's message is 11:11. Can we take one of these verses as 2014? Because this is going to be the arrival of the symbolic nature of time. So 11:11 is going to be the second message. So are we going to just take Judges 11:14 and place that as 2014? Is that what we're going to do? Shouldn't we just do that?
Well, we could if we're, because he sent messages, right, at that time.
Yeah, and that seems the most logical, that it's going to be Judges 11:14. So we'll just put it here as 11:14. I know you can't see it there. Or not 11:14, 11:4, I mean. So Judges 11:4. So it's 11:4. That's going to be 2014.
That was our informational time. Yeah, and that makes sense, because it was about then that they started bringing in the dates and the symbology of it.
Right. And so we're just saying that that is when they go to call him from the land of Tov. Right. So
the land of good.
Well, first they're going to have this in the process of time, which is the symbol. That's when Ammon makes war, right? So the next one is when they fetch him. So so we're going to say that that's the time of the end, right, in this line. And then we have an increase of knowledge from 2014 to some other point. And so then it says, so when it was that the children of Ammon made war against Israel, the elders of Gilead went to fetch Jephthah out of the land of Tob. And they said unto Jephthah, come and be our captain, that we may fight with the children of Ammon. Jephthah said unto the elders of Gilead, did not ye hate me and expel me out of my father's house? And why are ye come unto me now when ye are in distress? And the elders of Gilead said unto Jephthah, therefore we turn again to thee now, that thou mayest go with us and fight against the children of Ammon and be our head over all the inhabitants of Gilead. So I would say here that there's a conflict going on within the movement that we're going to have to mark the formalization of the message. So we know there's a conflict in 2014 in the movement, right? So we could just say that's the arrival of the message. The reason why this message is why we're even going to be looking at time in the way we do in this movement has to do with what happened in 2014. So let us try to, in our minds, to go back to 2014 and think about what happened there. So we know we had the conflict over the book of Joel, or Joel, however you say it. So you have this conflict within this movement. Now it's going to come to a head in 2014. The previous year, in 2013, Ezra 7:9 had begun to be looked at. It's not general knowledge in the movement. That's going to be Emiliano who sees this connection. And it's kind of odd because, in a sense, the Millerites understood the first day of the first month and the first day of the fifth month. It's just not something that Adventists generally looked at. Now, we know this conflict had been going on for a while. So in 2014, when this all comes to a head, you're going to have this message of Ezra 7:9 come to the fore. So that's 2014. So this is during this conflict. But we need to have this formalization of this message, right? And is there anything in the verses there that we read that would be a formalization that would parallel with Millerite history, for instance? In Millerite history, what is the formalization of Miller's message?
Of Miller's second message or the first message that they didn't know that they were actually giving?
Well, just Miller had his message. It's formalized. What causes its formalization? What do we mark?
1840.
No, 1833.
Well, that's when he received his credentials.
That's the formalization. You're thinking of the empowerment.
Right. You're right.
Okay. So the formalization is he is now given this responsibility. Time is given this responsibility in our line. Now, here's what I would do. So looking at this line is I would say that this is June 22nd. Okay. 2014. But we could say that a formalization happens in our movement. Now, usually what I mark is October 22. Oops. 2014. That's going to be my presentation. That's the center of the camp meeting. It's the midst of the week. It's Wednesday. October 22, 2014. Now, I present on the 20th and the 21st, one on the 20th and two on the 21st. October 2nd, 22nd is just, to me, a convenient date marking that camp meeting. So I'm not going to mark the beginning of it. I'm going to mark that middle of it, so to speak, the Wednesday, the midst of the week. Now, it's going to start Sunday, I believe. I'm trying to remember if they start Sunday evening or Monday. I think it's Sunday evening. Yeah, it's going to be Sunday evening because I present on Monday and Tuesday. So it starts Sunday evening. So you got Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and then Thursday, Friday, Saturday. So that's going to be the midst of the week. Okay, so we got October 22. It's the midst of that week. Of that camp meeting. June 22nd is the beginning of the camp meeting. And I'm saying that's the formalization because now time is presented in this movement, in the conflict of this division that has occurred. And the way that I would look at it is that what I was doing with time, Jeff would have seen as an ally to the opposition that had come from these groups that had left the movement. Whether he does that consciously or subconsciously, He knows about the first day of the first month. He sees what I'm doing with chronology and time, and he would see it as an ally to his defense of the movement against this attack. So that means the children of Ammon would represent the messages of Path of the Just and those other groups that left. But that would that make sense to people?
Yeah, to me.
Yeah, and it fits. We can take all the symbols. We can take Gilead. We can take the sons of Gilead. We can take Jephthah as this message that is the son of a harlot that is thrust out. And now in the midst of this conflict with this the kinship, the children of Ammon, that Israel has, we can see that that's a parallel to this movement's conflict with these groups that leave in 2014. Okay. So that's how we're looking at Jephthah. Now, Jephthah is,
that sounds logical.
And remember, Jephthah is the empowerment of the second angel in the line of the judges. It's marked by December 6, 2020. So one of the things we're going to have to see is that this line leads up to an acceptance of a message that's going to go through a process then that is going to be in its rejection, because the way that I look at this line, just in my estimation of it, is that the third angel arriving has to do with the message that arrives on December 6, 2020. So just to kind of jump ahead here, I'm trying to, we got like 12 minutes left. So what I would do is I would put, since I know where this line is, you know, what it's illustrating, that there is a message that arrives here, which is December 6th, 2020. Right. Let me see, write the whole date out. I actually don't like using abbreviations because then harder to search things. But anyway, so December 6th, 2020 is this third angel's message that arrives in relation to time. Right. So I'm saying that this message of Jephthah is December 6th, 2020. And it's a formalization of the message of the judges, like of the line of the judges. But what we're illustrating here is time in the movement to its rejection. And that would seem logical.
I agree.
And this would help us fill in these other waymarks. But again, we want to do that from the verses themselves. So when it comes to an empowerment of this message of time, I mean, a person could argue that Judges 11:11 fits there. But if we read the passage itself, I mean, we are going to come to Judges 11:11. So, and Jephthah said unto the elders of Gilead, if ye bring me home again to fight against the children of Ammon, and the Lord deliver them before me, shall I be your head? Right. So he asks these questions. He's like, are you really serious about this? And the elders of Gilead said unto Jephthah, the Lord be witness between us if we do not so according to thy words. And then Jephthah went with the elders of Gilead, and the people made him head and captain over them. And Jephthah uttered all his words before the Lord in Mizpah. So if we're going to take this chronologically, I think we would probably have to put 11:11 as the empowerment of the first angel. So we're going to do this. So I'm going to move this over. But I left Judges 11:11
We're
there.
not seeing it.
Okay, sorry about that. Oops. Okay, so what you're seeing, now you can see it.
Yes.
And you can see I put Judges 11:11. I left it where it was, but I put it here. But now I'm going to put here. Whoops. So this is going to be Jeff's presentation, right? Judges 11:11 is going to be this empowerment of that first message. That is, it's the end of that Levitical chiasm. But Judges 11:11, and we can see, is there a precedent for doing this?
Yes, with 9/11.
Yeah, even though here it's the symbol that we're putting, which 9/11 is a symbol, Judges 11:11 is a symbol. And then we're going to put March 31st, that's going to be Jeff's presentation of this January 11, 2020. And that's when Odilia is going to notice. Now, I'm just trying to see this here. I have a feeling I'm doing something wrong. So it's going to be March 31st. And see if I can find this. Sorry about this. I probably should have had this queued up, but I didn't know I was going to do this. So, it's going to be in. I don't know what's going on here. So it's going to be like Odilia is going to do this right after he first sees this. And then I'm going to respond to it. So I'm trying to find this. I'll find it in a second. So I think it's on March 31st that Odilio notices this, and then I respond to it. I think it's that evening that he does that, but I'm just going to check my email. I want to get it correct. Now, how does this relate, though, if we have the same symbol as the empowerment as well as the arrival? Even though they're separate dates.
Well, yeah, they are separate dates, but one is more, as you said, it's the empowerment of that first angel's message.
Mm-hmm.
And that second angel is, as you said, Jeff explaining it, basically. Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Then it becomes more accepted at that point because people didn't really get it. Right.
Yeah. So this is what Odilio sends me on March 31st, 2020. So he's going to show this. He took the diagram that Jeff did and he puts those dates there and he adds them together. Right. So he's going to do that on March 31st. But this was a presentation Jeff did on March 31st. Okay, so that's why I have March 31st there, 2020. And
Makes sense.
yeah. Now I'm going to respond to that, and then I'm going to show the 79 plus 911 plus 111. Now we also had done this with the first day of the first month, the first day of the fifth day of the fourth month, all those dates in Millerite history, and we found that they added up to because when we took 11 plus 54 plus 50, plus 15 plus 107, we ended up with 187. And I could do the same thing in 457 BC using the dates there. That is the ones that are given us. In 457 BC, we have the first day of the first month plus the first day. The 12th day of the first month plus the first day of the fifth month plus the 20th day of the ninth month and plus and there I'm just going to take out all the zeros, so I just use 29, and then the 10th day of the first month again is just going to be 1 1. You add those all together, you get 187. So we did that as well, two different ways. So we tied those things together. Yeah, so we're not going to get completed here today. So we can see that this 11:11, this verse, both fulfills the empowerment of the first message, but it's recognized and its recognition is the arrival of the second. So, well, that's where we're going to stop today. But we can see how this fits together in these lines and how this is all going to be pointing to December 6th. And then when we get to the end of the story of Jephthah, we have an explanation for the ephod and all that and what it means, right? So this again would fit into this structure quite well. And of course, we've done this before. We just didn't place the dates, right? So now we have definite dates in which we can mark these with the verses. And I didn't put the date for the formalization there. So maybe the best way to look at that was. So it should be 11/5, would be October 22. So I just didn't put that verse there. So they go to fetch him. I don't know if that's the best verse or not. Because in verse 6, they say, and they said unto Jephthah, come and be our captain that we may fight with the children of Ammon. And then he's going to have his question, his speech. But on 11, so we could say that goes all the way from 11:5 all the way up to 11:10 if we wanted to look at it that way. But that's going to be the formalization of the message. So, just put it this way, 5 to 10. Okay. Any final thoughts before we close with prayer? Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, thank you for the study this morning and for the way that you guide and lead. We pray, Lord, that you can continue to show us our history, our need of you, that we can sort through the truths that you have presented to us, and that we can present them simply to others. Be with us throughout this day, in the study this afternoon as well. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks, Theodore.